Well, what's landed on the bench today is a Singer Fashion Mate 237. Not super uncommon, but it's actually kind of a desirable machine. This one is in completely as found condition. All I have done is I have put it on the bench. I took a quick look at the wiring to make sure I wasn't going to electrocute myself. I plugged it in, and let's see. Well, we have some illumination. Let's see if the motor does anything. Okay, well, that's a positive start. She's a little noisy, but we'll dig into her and see what she needs. We'll find out what her needs, wants, and desires are. This is your typical, I guess these were made in the 60s. Maybe, I don't know, late 50s, early 60s. There's mostly metal, plastic top on them. But actually, this had to be the 60s, the Fashion Mates. Maybe into the 1970s. But it's definitely a step up from some of the other machines we see. Now, this is all metal. And let me get the camera in position so you can see inside what she looks like. You can see the crank here, that's transmitting the power down to drive mechanism down below. Let's see if we can tilt her back. Actually, why isn't she tilting is the question, or is there a there she goes. She was just hanging up. Ah, her missing bobbin case has been found. And somebody had put a class 66 bobbin into a class 15 bobbin case and probably wondered why the machine didn't work right. Well, whoever did that, when they die, NASA will not mourn their passing. Anyway, we have typical 15 class machine. That one connecting rod coming down is driving the powers the hook that comes in here. The fork that runs the feed dog rocker comes in here. This is pretty straightforward. It's very much like a regular 15 class machine, except that we can add a zigzag to it up top. The bottom end, with the exception of the mechanism here that lets you drop the feed dogs, is almost identical to what you would see on an earlier 15 class. It is nice, however, that Singer got with the program at this point and made it so that you could easily take the bobbin case, or should say take the hook in and out with a swinging gate setup. Let me turn that around, get that so I can see. And I know you can't see that at the moment, but that's, we'll get to that. And uses a standard 1 o'clock bobbin, class 15 bobbin case, which I'm going to, I have put a proper bobbin in right now, and we'll stick it back in the machine and get in there. What I don't like is this piece of plastic here, but we'll live with it. She's a little on the dirty side, but doesn't look too worn out. She looks pretty serviceable. Okay, let's take a quick peek. All right, the feed fork runs on this cam here. The crank, like I said, runs the oscillating hook. It looks like it should have a wick in there, which it does not. This would actually be a lot easier to take apart than the 15, the other, like a 15-30. And it seems the only plastic components are, well, the light housing and the top and nose covers, which screw into place. Let me sit myself down here a little lower and lower the camera. Let me take a quick peek. There's our stitch width connect control. And unlike like the 247, where the needle pivots this way, this one, it pivots this way to do the zigzag, which is actually kind of a nice way of nicer way of doing it. Although the 247 gives us the beautiful drop-in class 66 bobbin. Although whoever had this machine before tried to make it a 66 class. That was sarcasm. Before you start reaming me for that. All right, now just turning it through, it looks like we're getting full width on the zigzag. Let's see what moderate width looks like. This thing just might need a modicum of cleaning. The feed dogs are dropping. Feed dogs are back up. This might just need a little bit of a cleaning, and then she can be put into service. Let's see what she sounds like dry. Yeah, she sounds a little nasty. Let's get her full stitch length going. And does she reverse properly? You know what? Let's find out. I'm going to take my standard, just a piece of blue paper towel. We're just going to punch some holes in this. What I do like about this versus like the 247, and it has worked on two of those today, as a matter of fact, is that the reverse is like we would have on a 201 or the later model 15s. You stick it in reverse and it stays in reverse. I doubt that that's a true proportional reverse, but you know, we can find that out. Yeah, it probably is. Here, I'm going to set this so that the numbers are at 12. And we will just punch some holes here. And then we'll put it in reverse and see if it punches in the same hole. And it doesn't, but it's pretty close. But that, too, could be a matter of just cleaning. So, not exactly as precise as a 201 or 1591, but it's also a different class of machine. So, okay, I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to do some cleanup on this. I'm not going to completely disassemble it. I'm going to clean things in place, get her lubricated, and see what else she needs. This is going to be based on a need, not a anything else, and do what the machine absolutely needs, because I want to get this out of the house. I don't have a use for this machine, but I also don't want to hoard it either. Well, we're off to the races. As you can see, I'm going through and I'm cleaning out some of the nasty oil. I took the connecting rod cap off so I could clean the journal out and clean the inside of the connecting rod. I also installed a 3/16 inch felt oil wick into the connecting rod cap. That was missing. But I kept on going through and finding old, nasty, dried oil, wiping it out, putting fresh oil in. I said, I'm not going to go crazy on this machine. I'm not going to take things apart. I'm not going to polish. And I am testing the mechanism as I go along. You'll see that I've got constantly got some folded up paper towel under the presser foot. And well, right now I'm pulling the needle plate off, so no, it's not going to be under there because I had to take the feed dogs out. They were rather vile. But all along, while I'm going along, I'm testing the feed mechanism to make sure that's working correctly.
once again, that little Craftsman offset ratcheting screwdriver, just a lifesaver for getting in there to get to these tight spots for taking needle plates and feed dogs out. And I'm using a rotary tool with a small diameter wire brush to get all the nasty stuff out of the feed dogs. And that's my little Bauer mini rotary tool going in there to do a little detail cleaning with a straight end cup brush. And putting the feed dogs back in place. Once again, and putting the needle plate on when the feed dogs are back in. I can't stress enough how much that little Craftsman ratcheting screwdriver has saved my butt on a lot of occasions. Okay, needle plate's going back on. And this is after a short ice cream break. My wife came into the shop, said, if I offer you ice cream, can I tear you away from what you're doing? And I'm like, sure. So anyway, getting a needle, getting the pressure foot back on, and just giving her the once over, putting the screws back in the top. I know you can't see that. And threading her up once again. This is actually going to be some of the first stitches. I did run a few stitches with her last night. But just testing, trying to get thread tensions balanced. I really want to put a brand new bobbin case in with this machine. Old bobbin cases, the springs kind of lose it after a while. And you can keep on adjusting and keep on adjusting all you want. But they're not going to be super consistent. So I will probably replace the bobbin case on this before this machine goes out the door. But I had to chase the bobbin case tension quite a bit. But all in all, I was getting pretty happy with what I was seeing. And I hadn't even gotten into the bottom of the machine yet. This was just after working the top of the machine. I mean, it was feeding okay, so it was going to be needing a little bit of cleaning and lubrication down below. But all in all, so far, so good. And here we go, thinking real long and hard about that bottom again. And just wiping stuff down, getting in there with the brush, cleaning schmoo, and giving her a little bit of oil while we're about it. There's a lot of different oil points. I can't stress enough that you really should, if when in doubt, look at the instruction manual for your machine and find all the oiling points, but just don't overdo it. Something interesting to note about these machines versus the older black cast iron machines. The rock shafts, here the feed dog rock shaft and the lifter rock shaft. The older style machines used pivot screws that were screwed in and out, and then there was a lock nut on the end. Here you have your pivot points still screwing in and out, but they adjust. Instead of using a lock nut, they use set screws, which is very, very different than what we've seen on the earliest machines. And if you look at machines that even came after this, are around the same time, maybe the 247s, they used these plastic pivot points that had a set screw that came through the casting and hit it. But these weren't even screw and adjustable. These were just, you put them through the holes, you pressed them, you got it basically where you wanted it, and then you tightened one, and then you pushed the other one through the rest of the way, and you tighten the screw. These are made out of like a Delrin-type plastic. This came out of a machine that I used as parts to fix another machine for a customer. I'm not really sure what year these were made. Probably late 60s, early 70s.
this particular machine, this 237, this is a 237M. It's an Italian-made 237. These were made between 1967 and 1971. The serial number here, there is no data for it, so I can't give you an exact year on it. Not that it matters one iota. But the quality of the castings is... You can see how the castings went down in quality over the years. If you look back at one of my earlier videos, like from a 66 or a 99 or a 201, when I polish this stuff up, it comes up gleaming. This is just extremely rough. And if you look at this, this is actually a piece out of that 247. This is something I would expect to see on a cheap barbecue grill. This is pretty horrible. A lot of casting flash, and the areas that need to be well machined are beautifully machined, but the rest of it, they were in full cost-cutting mode when they were making these things. Likewise, like this is the fork for the stitch length regulator on 247. This literally, it's thin. I mean, a 99 fork is thicker than this is, and it just looks butt ugly. It's a butt ugly part, but I guess their thought was it's not a part that anybody's ever going to see unless they're working on the machine. So yeah, they built things down to a price point at this time. The nice thing about this particular machine that's on the bench, this is the mechanism is still all metal, with the exception of this plastic, almost like a, I think it's that same Delrin case that goes that retains the hook up by. But you know, it is what it is. They made them to a price. They sold a lot of them, and these are actually still kind of desirable, these 237s. A lot of people like them. I've heard tell that you can modify these in some way. I don't know. There's guys out there that do goofy stuff all the time. I'm just looking, making sure it gets a good home. But it says here, Fashion Mate Model 237. Then on the inside of the pillar here, where there's a decal that says Made in Italy, Model 237M-A. So, you can figure it out from there, what it is. Well, she got a lubrication. She's back together again. It's getting a little late. My wife is trying to sleep. Because she, unlike me, she has to leave the house when she goes to work. I work from home. So, out of respect for Elizabeth, I'm going to hold off until tomorrow, because this thing sounds like a machine gun when it's going, when it's running. And tomorrow I will come back and do just a little bit more cleanup on it, and then we'll run some stitches so you guys can judge for yourself how she works. Yeah, this bobbin thread tension is off the scale, so let's knock that way back. That's way too little. Split the difference. That's still a little heavy. Just a little less than that. Oops. That might be just a touch heavy. Let me bring it down just a little bit. Okay. That should be pretty close. Well, here it is the next day. Liz is off to work. And I am stuck home alone, completely unsupervised. How horrible of a thing is that? Anyway, Let's see how this 237 stitches, shall we? We'll set for stitch length of around 8. See what she does. That doesn't look too shabby. Actually, that looks damn good. Let's run it a little longer. Let's run it all the way out. Okay. Try her again. It's working. All right, let's try a zigzag. Let's take a wide zigzag at around 10. That sound good? Sure. Between 10 and 12, somewhere in that neck of the woods. And a nice wide zigzag. Oops. Zigzag, we should be knocking that tension way down. I think we got it. All right. I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to list this one, call this one in the books a success. Get this one listed. Get it out the door. I doubt it'll sell by Christmas. That's just a couple of days away. But I don't know. Tell me what you think down in the comments. What do you think about the machine? Is she worthy of being in someone's sewing room, being a part of someone's arsenal, or am I barking up the wrong tree? Now, I know I didn't go crazy on the servicing of this one. I just went through, I did a basic cleaning, basic lubrication. Honestly, I don't like the idea of taking these completely apart the way I do, like, say, a 66 or a 99, but generally these don't need it. So, you tell me. Am I barking up the wrong tree, or am I on point with this? All right, thanks for watching. We'll see you on the next one.